I'm Doug Beaumont. I've been asked to share the story of how I became Catholic. I was not a cradle Catholic or even a cradle Christian. I actually was an adult heading into college before I became a believer at all. And it was not for many years before I became a Catholic. So what really got me started into Christianity was the evangelism done by people who not only knew what they believed, but why they believed it. And so right after high school, I became a Christian, and I began learning and going off to college, joining Christian groups and things like that. And because my conversion had been so influenced by these apologists, these people who knew how to defend the faith, it became something of an interest for me as well. And so all through college, I studied theology and apologetics, and it really became an interest of mine. And that is why in the year 2000, I moved to North Carolina and I started to attend Southern Evangelical Seminary. It was a school started by one of my heroes of the faith, Norman Geisler. And it was a school that was dedicated not just to theology and missions work, but also to the practice of apologetics and philosophy. So by 2004, I was Norm Geisler's assistant. I actually have my name in a couple of his books. And I was ready to graduate. I got a master's degree in apologetics in 2004 and actually started teaching at the school because we started a Bible college. So for the next several years, I was a professor at Southern Evangelical Seminary and Bible College. And it was an amazing time of discovery and study. I was speaking coast to coast at various seminars and conferences. I got published a couple of times, so things really seemed to be going well for me as far as the evangelical ministry world, and I just could not have been happier. All of that began to change in about 2008, 2009, when some bad stuff started happening at the school. There was some infighting, some divisions over a church that we had started. And as disappointing as that was, it wasn't a huge shock because I believed in human depravity and sin, and I knew that just because you were a good apologist, that didn't make you immune from committing acts of sin and that sort of thing. But what really bothered me was the church's almost complete inability to handle the situation. What it started was my investigation into some issues that I had been considering for quite some time, and especially now because I was starting to work on my doctorate degree at Southern Evangelical Seminary, a degree program I actually helped start. So at about the same time that I was working on my PhD and struggling with these issues with the church, I was starting to look kind of farther and farther outside of evangelicalism to just see what else the church really had to offer. Of course, my whole life I had known that there were various divisions in Protestant Christianity, but they just weren't any divisions that I had ever especially looked into very much because I just wasn't really that interested. I believed in sola scriptura. I believed that the Bible held all we needed to know, and as far as I was concerned, all one really needed to do to be a good, knowledgeable Christian was learn more and more about the Bible, but also learn hermeneutics, interpretation, philosophy, and a lot of the other things that went along with good Bible interpretation. And because most of the people that I knew that thought that way believed the same way, other beliefs of Christians were not always a huge interest. However, as I entered into my doctoral studies, I discovered that there were some apologetic issues that I had never quite had resolved for me in my years of education up until this point. And the two biggest ones were the canon of Scripture and the creeds that helped us interpret Scripture in an orthodox way. My issue with the canon was that although I had been trained to defend the Bible in general, and even a couple of books in particular, I knew enough to know that the Bible was not a single book. It's really a library of books that are all put together into one bound volume, and the kinds of things you can do to defend some of the books in the Bible don't work for other ones. And so critics rightly can point out a problem in one book that doesn't necessarily get solved by the way you would defend another book. And all of this led back to the main question, which was, why are these books in the Bible in the first place? Now, I had been taught that there were certain criteria that the early church used to determine which books belonged in the Bible and which did not, but there was always some issues with some of the books. None of the books seemed to have all of the criteria met, and if those criteria were actually what the church used to include the books they included, then it seemed like we might have a different list. And for someone who believed very strongly in sola scriptura, the idea that the Bible alone is God's revelation, the ability to identify that revelation by knowing which books were inspired and part of the canon and which were not was incredibly important, and I hadn't really found a good, rock-solid answer to that question. The other main issue that I had was the idea of orthodoxy, the idea that Christianity had a certain group of essential teachings that everybody had to agree on if they wanted to be Christian, but then another layer of non-essential teachings that were okay to disagree on. Now, my problem wasn't with that idea itself, but rather identifying which was which. Now, as a Protestant, I knew that there were hundreds of different things that Christians could disagree on. And I'd always been told that, well, the way you tell the difference between an essential and a non-essential is by whether or not it would affect salvation. So, for example, if you don't believe in the Trinity, or you don't believe that Jesus is God, well, then the Jesus you believe in isn't the Jesus of Scripture. It's another Jesus that can't save you. And so belief in the Trinity and the Incarnation and things like that are definitely essentials that you have to believe in if you want to be a truly saved Christian. However, I was taught issues like baptism and what exactly was communion and that sort of thing. You didn't get saved or not saved based on your belief in those things, and so they were non-essentials. They were secondary issues that were okay to disagree on. However, it interested me to see that for some groups, some things that I had been taught were secondary and non-essential were considered essential. So, for example, if you're Catholic, you recognize that right there in the Bible, Jesus says that if you don't eat his flesh and drink his blood, you don't have eternal life. That's in John 6. You have Peter saying that baptism saves you. So, on the surface at least, it seemed like baptism and communion might very well be essential issues. And of course, the main problem with this whole essentials and non-essentials idea is that the Bible itself, which is supposed to be our main resource for theology, doesn't label which things are essential and which ones are not. Now, the champion of this whole entire program was Norm Geisler himself, and I discovered as I researched his writings that every time he published a list of the essentials and non-essentials, they were different. He literally had a different list of essentials every single time he had a major publication come out on what are the essentials and non-essentials. And so I knew just from looking at his writings that this system clearly didn't work. So I started looking into history. Now, this was interesting because at that time, Southern Evangelical Seminary did not have any church history classes in their grad school. So I was kind of on my own. And as I discovered how the canon really came to be and how orthodoxy really came to be decided, I started noticing that it was always the ancient church that was involved in that occurrence. I found out that it was the church at Rome, at the Council of Rome, that first determined the canon of scripture that we have today. I discovered that it was the church at Nicaea and Constantinople that created the very first ecumenical creed by which all Christians are to be bound, and which, by the way, included a number of things that were not considered essential by my school. And so my faith, if you will, in sola scriptura really began to waver. I wasn't entirely sure how an evangelical or even just a regular Protestant Christian could completely justify the canon itself without asserting a level of authority to the church that created the canon that they did not want to give it. Further, even if there was some way to kind of reverse engineer the canon in such a way that we could ignore the fact that the church was actually who created it, there was the issue of interpretation. How do I know when I have an orthodox interpretation of that scripture and when I don't? And so sola scriptura for me became a really big issue, and as the pieces of it started to kind of fall apart, I realized I was in a bit of trouble because I knew that sola scriptura was one of the main foundational pillars of Protestantism, and I wasn't sure what I was going to be able to do if I decided that sola scriptura didn't work. The next big blow to my Protestantism came as I read more and more about sola fide, the other major foundational pillar of Protestantism. Sola fide said that we are saved by faith alone. And incredibly, I discovered that James 2:24 was the only verse in the Bible that contained the words justification by faith alone. And what it said was that we are not justified by faith alone. Now, this was a huge eye-opener for me because I knew a number of proof texts that kind of seemed to indirectly teach that justification was by faith alone. But I had never realized that the only verse in Scripture to use those words actually said that it wasn't. Now, I knew how to interpret that verse in a way that agreed with my evangelical theology. But it occurred to me that here I was, a Protestant, who was doubting sola scriptura, but who had as a foundational, in fact, the primary, one of the very first major doctrines to come out of this alleged sola scriptura, was one that directly contradicted a verse of scripture. Now, I knew that if the Catholic Church taught anything that was directly contradicting the words of scripture, we would have been all over that. We would have been attacking the Catholic Church left and right and just scoffing at them for how poorly they handled scripture. And yet, I had never seen a verse that actually contradicted Catholic teaching. Now, there were several verses that I believed taught against what the Catholic Church taught, but none of them were a direct verbal contradiction. And what I came to realize was that if a group can take a direct verbal contradiction of scripture and somehow spin it theologically to make it work, there's no stopping a hermeneutic that can get around a direct verbal contradiction. So whatever scriptural ammunition that I thought I had against the Catholic Church was definitely not going to work. It was going to be a dud if it was fired because they had something on us that was far more of a problem than anything we had on them. Now, this is several years down the line. I want to stress that at this point, I was not looking to become Catholic. The Catholic Church as an entity was not even really on the table. It wasn't something I even wanted to look at. I was not interested in becoming Catholic. I thought they were weird. I didn't like a lot of their beliefs. It was just not something I was into. I was still reading evangelical scholars that were convincing me that evangelicalism couldn't answer the question of the canon or the creeds or of sola fide. And believe me, I tried. I tried looking outside of evangelicalism to Anglicanism, but I kept running up against problems that I couldn't seem to overcome. And eventually I saw the Catholic Church looming in my future. If I was going to answer the problem of the canon and of the creeds, I was going to have to look to the ancient church because, like it or not, historically speaking, it is just an objective fact that it was the ancient church that determined the canon, and it was the ancient church that determined the creeds that still unite all of Orthodox Christianity. There's just no getting around that. There's also no historical way of getting around the fact that there is no modern Protestant church that existed back when the canon and the creeds were determined. So, if I wanted to be a part of the church that determined the canon and the creeds, I was going to have to leave Protestantism. I loved Thomas Aquinas. I loved reading Augustine and Chrysostom and the early church fathers. And I realized if these guys were alive today, they wouldn't be attending my church. And the crazy thing was, my church taught that these guys basically figured out Christianity, and yet somehow they got the gospel wrong. So going back to the essentials versus the non-essentials, if what affects your salvation, if what you think about the message of the gospel is an essential, then what I had to affirm as an evangelical, an orthodox, if you will, evangelical, was that the early church fathers, the medieval thinkers, all of these guys that shaped Christianity into what it is, weren't Christian. Or they were at least very questionable Christians because although they taught orthodoxy and all the things that we believed about the canon and the creeds, they had somehow gotten the gospel wrong. And the final nail in the coffin, if you will, was that as I studied more and more about history, I came to realize that the Protestant narrative of a church that started off very faithful, figured out the canon, figured out the creeds, and then kept going, and then kind of corrupted at some point and needed to be restored or reformed during the Reformation of the 16th century, really didn't make very much sense. And the reason is that several of the things that Protestants objected to Catholicism and Eastern Orthodoxy about were already settled before the first creed and before the Council of Rome that was the first one to determine the canon. In other words, you already had the church hierarchy. You already had Marian veneration. You already had a belief in baptism as saving, even infants. And you already had a belief in Jesus' real presence in the Eucharist. So if you're going to say the church corrupted, drawing that line becomes very tricky, because if you draw it after the canon and the creeds, you've already got most of the things you don't like about Catholicism. And if you draw it earlier, say right after the death of the apostles, then the church loses its authority to determine the canon and the creeds, which it did, and you are left without any kind of objective measure of the canon or of Christian orthodoxy. So, in 2014, 5 years after I began this study journey into the church, I was received into full communion with the Catholic Church. And after that, obviously, I had to find new work, had to find a lot of new friends, and had to rebuild my entire ministry network, which, praise be to God, has largely occurred. I've won some friends back. I don't blame them necessarily for walking away from me as I became Catholic, because it was a difficult time for all of us in different ways. And ministry-wise, I've been picked up by Catholic Answers. I've been published by Ignatius Press, Tan Books. I have a book from Ignatius Press called Evangelical Exodus. It's actually a compilation of stories from a bunch of my friends that came into the Catholic Church out of Southern Evangelical Seminary. And we've got 4 great chapters at the end that go through Sola Fide, Sola Scriptura, the Canon, and the Creeds. I just had a book come out from Catholic Answers called With One Accord, and it basically teaches Catholics how to explain Catholicism to Protestants in a way that Protestants will understand, because it takes most of the most contentious theological differences that Catholics and Protestants have and shows how they actually have a common principle behind them, so that Catholicism isn't quite as weird as Protestants might think, and vice versa. My ministry now is not so much about going out and getting the non-believers, but rather trying to build bridges, trying to show people how it is that Catholicism actually makes sense. And I'm hoping that that ministry will bear fruit as I go forward in the world. So that is my story. If this has been a valuable video to you, I'd love it if you liked it. And be sure to subscribe to the channel and click that bell notification so that I can tell you the next time some videos drop. God bless.